there are times that we may want to repeat a task a number of times. For example, let's say we send a message to a user. If that message cannot be delivered, perhaps we want to retry three times. Now, for simplicity, let's imagine this print statement is equivalent to sending a message. In a real-world program, to send a message to a user, we have to write 5 to 10 lines of code. Now, if you want to retry three times, we don't want to repeat all that code. That is ugly. That's when we use a loop. We use loops to create repetition. So here is how it works. We start with for, number, in. We have a built-in function called range. Now, how many times we want to repeat this task? Let's say 3 times. So we call range and pass 3 as an argument. Now, similar to our if statements, we need to terminate this line with a colon. Enter, we get indentation. So in this block, we can write all the statements that should be repeated 3 times. Let's do a print, a message like attempt. Save the changes, run the program. So we have attempt printed 3 times, beautiful. Now, what is this number? Let's take a look. It's a variable of type integer. So let's pass it as the second argument to the print function, number. Run the program. This is what we get, 0, 1, 2. So here we have a for loop. This for loop is executed 3 times. In each iteration, number will have a different value. Initially, it will be 0. In the second iteration, it will be 1. And finally, in the last iteration, it will be 2. Now here we can do something fun. We can add 1 to this, run the program, and now the messages that we print are kind of more meaningful or more user-friendly, like attempting number 1, attempting number 2, and so on. We can take this to the next level. So we can pass another argument. Here I'm going to add an expression. One more time, number plus 1. So we'll get 1, 2, 3. Now I want to put this expression in parentheses. So let's select this, put it in parentheses, and then multiply it by a dot. So here we have a string that is multiplied by a number. The result will be that string repeated that number of times. Let's take a look. So run the program. See? That's pretty cool, isn't it? Now let me show you one more thing before we finish this lecture. As you saw, this range function generates numbers starting from 0 all the way up to this number here, but it doesn't include this number. Here we can pass another argument, say start from 1 and finish before 4. With this change, we don't need to add 1 to number every time, because in the first iteration, this number variable will be set to 1. So we can simplify our code and make it cleaner. Let's run it one more time. We get the exact same result. We can also pass a third argument as a step. So I'm going to change the second argument to 10 and pass 2 as a step. Look at the result. These are the numbers we get, 1, 3, 5, and so on. So pretty useful. You're going to use this function a lot in real-world applications. Continuing with the example from the last lecture, let's imagine the scenario where after the first attempt, we can successfully send the message. In that case, we want to jump out of this loop. We don't want to repeat this task of sending a message 3 times. Let me show you how to implement this. So in this demo, I'm going to simulate the scenario where we can successfully send a message. So we define a variable, successful, and set it to true. Now here, after this print statement, we'll have an if statement, if successful, colon, then perhaps we can print successful. Now here we want to jump out of this loop. For that, we use the break statement. Let's run this program and see what happens. So there you go. After the first attempt, we are successful and there are no more attempts. So once again, I want you to pay great attention to the indentation here, because that's one of the common issues amongst beginners. So here's our for loop. These two lines are indented with 4 spaces, and they belong to our for loop. In every iteration, these two lines will be executed. Now, when we get to line 4, if this condition is true, then these two lines will be executed because both these lines are indented below this if statement. Now, let's take this program to the next level. What if we attempt 3 times and we still cannot send an email? Perhaps we want to display a different message to the user. We say, hey, we tried 3 times, but it didn't work. So I'm going to change successful to false. Now at the end, here we can add an else statement. This is what we call a for else statement. What we put under this else statement will only be executed if this loop completes without an early termination. So if we never break out of this loop, then the else statement will be executed. So here we can print a message like attempted 3 times and failed. So run the program. See what we get. 3 attempts followed by this message. Attempted 3 times and failed. In contrast, if we change successful to true, because we terminate this loop using this break statement, what we have in the else block will not be executed. Take a look. Run the program. We have 1 attempt, successful, done. In programming, we have this concept called nested loops. So we can put one loop inside of another loop, and with this, we can get some interesting results. Let me show you. So I'm gonna start with this loop for x in range 5, colon. Now inside of this loop, I'm gonna add another loop. So for y in range 3, colon. And then in our second loop, I'm gonna add a print statement. Here we can use formatted strings to display coordinates. Remember formatted strings? So we have F followed by quotes. Now here we add parentheses for our coordinates. First, we want to display X and then comma followed by Y. Let's run this program and see what happens. There you go. Pretty cool, isn't it? So we get 0 and 0, 0 and 1, 0 and 2. Then we get 1 and 0, 1 and 1, 1 and 2, and so on. Now let me explain how exactly Python interpreter executes this code. So here we have 2 loops. This is what we call the outer loop, and this is the inner loop. So the execution of our program starts here. In the first iteration of this loop, x is 0. Now we get to this statement, which is a child of this for statement, because it's indented 4 times. This statement itself is a loop. So what we have inside of this loop will be executed 3 times. In the first iteration, x is 0 because we're still in the first iteration of the outer loop. And y is also 0 because we're in the first iteration of the inner loop. That is why we get 0 and 0. Now we go to the second iteration of this inner loop. In this iteration, y will be 1, whereas x is still 0. That is why we get 0 and 1. And similarly, in the third iteration of our inner loop, we'll get 0 and 2 in the terminal. Now we're done with the execution of the inner loop, so the control moves back to our outer loop. Here we'll be in the second iteration, so x will be 1. And then we start here again. So we have to execute this inner loop 3 times. In the first iteration, y will be 0 and x is 1. So here we have 1 and 0, then we'll get 1 and 1 and 1 and 2. You got the point. So this is all about nested loops. So you have learned how to use for loops to repeat one or more statements in your programs. Now let's dive deeper and see what this range function returns. So earlier you learned about the built-in type function. With this function, we can get the type of an object. So if I pass 5 here and run this program, this is what we get. So the type of this number or this object is int or integer. Now let's look at the type of the value that we get from the range function. So as an argument, we pass range of a number. Let's run this program. So this range function returns an object of type range. So in Python, we have primitive types like numbers, strings, and Booleans, but we also have complex types. Range is an example of one of those complex types. Throughout this course, you're going to learn about a lot of other complex types. Now, what is interesting about this range object is that it's iterable, which means we can iterate over it or use it in a for loop. That is why we can write code like this. So this range function returns a range object, which is iterable, which means we can iterate over it. In each iteration, x will have a different value. Now, range objects are not the only iterable objects in Python. Strings are also iterable. So here, we can add a string like Python. Now, in each iteration, x will hold one character in this string. Let me show you. So print x, and I'm going to delete these two lines here. Let's run this program. So in each iteration, we'll get one character and print it. We have another complex type called list, which we use to store a list of objects. So we add square brackets. This indicates a list. Now we can add a list of numbers or a list of strings, like a list of names. You will learn about lists later in the course. So let's run this one more time. As you can see, we can iterate over lists. In each iteration, we'll get one object in this list. Now, later in the course, I will show you how to create your own custom objects that are iterable. For example, you will learn how to write code like this. For item in shopping cart, print item. So shopping cart is going to be a custom object that you will create. It's not going to be an integer or a string or Boolean. It's a custom object. It has a different structure. And we'll make it iterable so we can use it in a for loop. And in each iteration, we can get one item in the shopping cart and print it on a terminal. All right, time for an exercise. I want you to write a program to display the even numbers between 1 to 10. So when you run this program, you should see 2, 4, 6, and 8. And after these, I want you to print this message. We have 4 even numbers. Now here's a quick hint before you get started. You should call the range function with 1 and 10. Do not use the third argument, which is called step. So basically, I want you to iterate over all the numbers between 1 to 10. Check if each number is an even number and then print it on the terminal. So pause the video, spend 2 minutes on this exercise. When you're done, come back, continue watching. So we start with a for loop for number in range 1 to 10, colon. We check to see if the remainder of division of this number by 2 equals 0. So if number modulus 2 equals 0, then we print this number. Now let's run this program. So we get 2, 4, 6, 8. Beautiful. Now to count the even numbers, we need a separate variable. So let's call that count. Initially, we set it to 0. Now in this if block, every time we find an even number, we need to increment count. So we set count plus equals 1. And finally, after our for loop, we can print a formatted string. We have count even numbers. Let's run the program, and here's the result. Hi guys, thank you for watching this tutorial. My name is Mosh Hamadani, and I have tons of tutorials like this for you on my channel. So be sure to subscribe, and also please like and share this video. If you want to learn Python properly from scratch with depth, I have a comprehensive Python tutorial for you. The link is below this video, so click the link to get started. Thank you, and have a fantastic day.